Jesus, we sing. We sing because we know you are alive. You are alive. And because you're alive, Lord, you are home.
Prophets like John the Baptizer, who had come preaching that the kingdom was close. But this new prophet, this Jesus of Nazareth, seemed so different.
One they call a teacher.
They say that he could pass this way.
Reached out to Jesus, his words and his life had touched her. She had watched from afar as he cared for the poor who could give him nothing in return, as he embraced the lowly that others avoided, as he put his arms around lepers and made friends with tax collectors. She believed that if she could only reach him, even to touch the hem of his garment, Jesus could change her life too.
Thank you.
week, the master's words had been serious. The night he celebrated Passover with his closest friends, he acted with such love and spoke with such reassurance. He gave thanks for the bread and offered up the wine. Yet his disciples had no idea that what was about to happen would give this last meal and this last evening with him a whole new meaning. That evening was filled with sweet memories for his disciples. Jesus told them that he loved them, and he called them friends. He said that even though he was going away, he would send someone to comfort them and help them. Later that night in the garden, the sound of soldiers' footsteps, the smell of blazing torches, and the shouts as he was arrested, they were ugly. Painful scenes seared into their minds. Yet these were memories that could never and should never be erased. Down his life to pay the price for our sin.
What an amazing sacrifice. What a beautiful gift of love. And yet, for those who had dared to follow all the way to Golgotha, what happened there must have been incredibly grieving. Their final glimpse of Jesus was as Joseph and Nicodemus lowered his broken, lifeless body from the cross. It was the end of every hope for the new kingdom that had seemed so close just days before. It was the darkness that falls when dreams die. It was the agony of deep sorrow and the emptiness of loss. What else was there to do now but go home?
Away with nothing to
Friends, it's all true. Jesus rose to life that morning, and he still lives today. So there's hope. Whatever your need, whatever your heartache, if you feel like an outcast, if you feel unworthy, if you're hurting or held captive, come to Jesus. Jesus touches you and heals you and sets you free. Well, he said it himself. If the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Once that happens, you'll want to join all those who have been changed by his grace. You'll want to sing his praises and tell him how much you love him.
Praise you all my days.
Perfect in all your ways.
Perfect in all your ways.
Hail.
see your kingdom come.
Not my will, let yours be done.
Not my will, let yours be done.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You take me into the land.
You take me into the land.
We will conquer in your name.
We will conquer in your name. You are home.
Friends, I just have a few short thoughts on Palm Sunday. If you were paying attention to the sermon that was the cantata, brought us all the way through Holy Week. But I do have a few thoughts. You heard me say something to the children, and I went down a little research rabbit hole with this. Parades are for winners. They are. The very earliest parades are recorded on cave walls of prehistoric people, tribal people welcoming home hunters after a successful hunt. As long as there have been winners, there have been parades. Today's a day we celebrate a moment in time that Jesus was declared a winner. Today we celebrate and we even reenact the Jesus Parade. But the Jesus Parade is different than any other parade because it signals a victory he has not yet won. Almost everything about Jesus is caught up in a timeless continuum. And Palm Sunday is probably the most obvious. It's no surprise that God made flesh, a timeless God who's bound up for a little while in our finite reality, would speak sometimes and behave sometimes in ways that are in an out of order. Palm Sunday might be the most dramatic example of this. A parade for the winner of a war that has not been won yet. In he comes, though, the fulfillment of prophecy, riding on a donkey and greeted with cheers and adoration of all the people crowding the streets of Jerusalem. Those cheers are really desperate cries. They're desperate cries of conquered, occupied, tired people whose dream it is to be free. Every Hosanna is shouted in expectation, the expectation of victory. Over time, much has been made of the fickleness of this crowd. How quickly they turn against Jesus and demand his crucifixion. It's like 4 days. It's easy to criticize, but we are no different. We do the very same thing to our winners when they disappoint us. We crucify them. The crowd in Jerusalem that day was no different than any other adoring crowd that ends up disappointed by their winner. We would do well to remember we're exactly like that crowd in Jerusalem. We still greet Jesus with loud praises and high expectations. And we still crucify him in our hearts just a little bit when he disappoints us. When he doesn't show up in time, to serve our needs and heal our ills and feed our hungry and end our wars. We too are stuck in our reality with our limited view of the horizon and our desperate need to be free of all that is wrong. Palm Sunday kicks off a series of agonizing losses, surrenders even. Sometimes a surrender feels worse than a loss. And yet he surrenders. Humiliating public weakness and devastating acceptance of a punishment. What fools they felt like for treating this loser like a winner. What a joke he became. How could he win now? There's no coming back from losses like that. But aren't we the lucky ones? Aren't we the blessed for knowing the rest of the story? Friends, we're just like them, only we've seen a few more battles. What they didn't know and what we do have the benefit of knowing was that they were witnessing one battle and not the whole war. They were stuck in a moment of linear history, and Jesus was not. The people who greeted Jesus that day as a winner, they were not wrong. They weren't wrong. That's why we still have Jesus parades. That's why we still should have Jesus parades. They were right. They were right, and so are we. Jesus is King. He was and is and eternally will be the winner. He's already the winner of a war that is still being waged because he is God, who, unlike us, is unbound by time. Parades are for winners. So let us have our Jesus parades. Let us greet him as the King. Let us greet him as the King when God's word commands creation, when God's spirit makes Mary a mother, when God's breath awakens him in the tomb, and when he returns on the clouds. Hosanna! Hosanna! He is, in every battle, our winner and our King. Amen.